Hello and welcome to part 2 of my Videomaster Superscore trilogy. If you've not seen part 1 yet, click on the link and we'll wait for you to catch up. Seen part 1? Great, then we'll continue. In the last episode, we ended on a small cliffhanger. I had just broken the inductor on the circuit board, causing the pitcher to scramble. But did this geek give up, or did I hold aloft my soldering iron and vow to repair it? Well, I certainly learnt the hard way that a metal screwdriver will break an inductor's fragile ferrite core, turning this into this. The inductor and the capacitor work as an LC circuit, an electrical resonator, with electrical energy oscillating between the inductor's magnetic field and the capacitor's electric field. In the superscore, this needs to happen 2 million times per second, with the inductor being tunable so that that frequency can be finally adjusted. While I was making part 2, my eBay alert let me know about another superscore for sale, and as soon as I saw it, I knew it was something special. The first clue was a large solid speed arrow instead of being three thinner arrows, and the lack of the colour red in the superscore part of the logo. Then I saw the next photo, and there, peeking out from behind the instruction manual, was an assembly manual. This was one of the £24.95 self-assembly kits. So I beat out the competition with some last second sniping, winning the item and the information it contained. The original owner had written in pencil a date of 3rd of December 1976. I like to think this was given as an early Christmas present, so they would have had time to assemble it to play during the Christmas holidays. In the bottom of the box was this gift label. It makes me happy to think of Janet gifting this to George. George did a great job of making it, and was even an early modder, making a custom hole in the case to be able to adjust the inductor while the case was still on. The assembly manual contains step-by-step instructions, circuit diagrams, and even a bill of materials. The RF module at £6 and the AY3 8500 at £10 being the most expensive components. If I had seen this manual earlier, I would have heeded the strong warning and not used a metal tool to adjust the inductor. At the end of this video, I've put an old-fashioned data burst. If you want to pause the video, you can step through each page of the manual. There aren't many problems a geek with internet access and a credit card can't solve, and it wasn't long before I found a company called Coilcraft selling what looked like the perfect replacement inductor. I just had to figure out which of the many values I needed to buy, as the inductor didn't have a value on it. At the time, I only had General Instruments reference design document to go by, and they showed a 90 microhenry inductor for the 2 MHz LC circuit. So I chose an inductor with a nominal value of 87.2 microhenry, with a range of 48 to 126. When I received the assembly manual, the 100 microhenry inductor it showed was well within range. As well as the new inductor, I purchased an adjustment tool, but a shaped matchstick would have done just as well according to the 1976 assembly manual. Will it work in my superscore though? First, I need to snip off the 3 additional legs that aren't connected to the coil, leaving 2 coil connected pins and the 2 case shield pins. Then I solder it in position. Testing the superscore showed a picture that was no better or worse than before, but then I haven't adjusted the inductor yet. Slowly rotating the inductor core thankfully brings a picture back. Just see how excited those bats are to be back. They're jumping for joy. The assembly manual calls this movement a beat signal, and when careful adjustment of the inductor reduces this to no or very slow movement, the desired 2 MHz signal will have been achieved. The image doesn't appear to be as smeary as before, but the picture is still too bright and there is still some smearing of the ball. I have a thought that the overall brightness is controlled by the resistor bringing the composite signal into the RF modulator. This is a 3.3 kilo-ohm resistor, which I remove from the board. I tried different values and settled on a 5.6 kilo-ohm resistor to knock the brightness down a bit. finish, I solder the lid back onto the RF modulator. While I have the iron hot, I can't resist putting back in better the two capacitors I replaced in the previous video. Not all the player controllers work smoothly, causing the bats to jump erratically. The two potentiometers in the console are the same as the extension controller, so I'll just show how to refurbish the external one. Once the four tabs have been prized open, the potentiometer comes apart easily. The potentiometer acts as a variable resistor, with the phosphor bronze wiper moving across a dark band of resisted material, varying the amount of resistance in the circuit. A gentle clean with a cotton bud and some isopropyl alcohol is all that's needed to clean away over 30 years of oxidisation and grime. When reassembling, be careful not to force the tabs back down too tight, or it will make the potentiometer stiff to turn and wear it out quicker. Plasticizers in some PVC coated cables can migrate to the polystyrene foam packaging where they touch. It both melts the polystyrene and can cause the cable coating to become brittle. Make sure you prevent them from touching whilst in storage. Again, a little isopropyl alcohol is all that is needed to gently clean off the residue. Thankfully, I've managed to repair my mistake and keep my first Superscore as original as possible. With the RF connection, the picture's reasonably good, but it doesn't matter because that one's gone on my display shelf. But I still have that other Superscore, and I'm going to convert that one to composite video and put it in my gaming unit. Outwardly, it looks the same as my Superscore, but in slightly better condition. Let's open it up and see if it's different inside though. This is a later second revision model. They appear to have learned and added a simple zip tie for strain relief of the RF cable, along with a couple of new capacitors. But most interesting is an additional socket allowing both controls to be extended with external paddles. I won't be using any part of the RF modulator, so I'll remove it. I'll keep it in a bag, in the box, just in case I need it again. The foam anti-vibration pad on the back of the speaker has decomposed, so I'll take that off too and replace it later. The sellotape is just to help reduce any mess to clean up. This unit has suffered battery leakage at some point, and the terminals are corroded. I take them off the board to make it easier to clean them. a little corroded, but a fine sanding pad soon brings them back to a shiny finish. You might notice a new cable coming from where the RF modulator was. This was my first failed attempt to get a good composite signal. For some strange reason that I couldn't work out, it caused both bats to disappear. As before, all switch contacts are cleaned with isopropyl alcohol. There is also some corrosion residue to clean inside the case, caused by the battery leakage. To produce a good clean composite signal, this is the circuit I concocted using inspiration from other circuits I had seen on the internet. It uses a 7805C voltage regulator to provide 5 volts to the circuit from the Superscore's 9 volt power rail, a CD4075 logical OR gate to combine the field, ball and left player video signals. The combined signal is then amplified using a 2N3904 transistor, and then further combined with the sync signal and the right player signal, which can have its brightness level adjusted by a potentiometer to get just the right shade of grey. The circuit fits perfectly where the RF modulator used to be, and is mounted with sticky pads. The long blue leads bring the sync and separate video signals to the board. The two leads in the bottom right corner of the board tap into the power and ground points the RF modulator used. Instead of using the separate right player video output, as this is an AY3-8550, I can tap into the unused whole picture output. I use one of the holes used by the RF modulator to reach the unused pin 28 on the other side of the board. This not only gives me the right player signal, but also made the rest of the signals I had combined sharper. I'm not sure why, but it works and I'm not complaining. To test a Superscore easily outside of its case, you can provide positive 9 volts to the speaker side of R6 and use the battery spring as your ground connection. I've also replaced all the electrolytic capacitors as before. The finishing touch is to clean the old glue from the back of the sticker and use some double-sided tape to reattach it. Made in Great Britain, not something you see much of these days. The finished console with composite video and 2 extended controllers, over 40 years old but still looking stylish. The video output is now crisp and much better than the RF signal. It looks even better in person. I hope you've enjoyed watching this Superscore adventure so far and possibly even learned something from my mistakes. I know I have. In part 3, I'll take a look at the light pistol and see if I can get it to work with the CRT TV and possibly even other types. I also want to take a look at the box and see if I can fix the tears in it to make it better for display. But that'll be some time yet, because I want to take a break from the Superscore and do something else for my next video. If you like what you've seen, and you haven't already, click subscribe and then click that bell, and that'll tell you when I've uploaded my next video. Until then, goodbye and see you next time.
Let me see your identification. We don't need to see his identification. Follow me. Move along.